time and so that we can continue. I'm thinking right now about the words of a psychologist philosopher here in Ontario, Stuart Shanker, who encourages us, if we see the child differently, then we see a different child. And I can say that after yesterday's session, I actually looked at my own kids differently. And I appreciate that. The pizza tasted better as a result. And so we continue on from the large scale democratic education down to the level of the teacher, and happy to introduce Stephen Sutajan, who's going to introduce Derry, our speaker for the democratic teacher. Really looking forward to this. Take it away, Stephen.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone. Can you hear me?
Loud and clear.
Excellent. Wow, it's a real honor to be here with all of you today. My name is Stephen Skotayan. I'm an elementary school teacher, first and foremost, and now a union leader here in the Ottawa public school system. And as an educator, it's really quite amazing to be introducing Derry Hannam, because as an educator, I've always said, I'm always naturally seeking out my inner subversive. In fact, I've always been asking my friends and colleagues, what was your subversive act today? And I think that's a really important thing to understand. I'm going to get into a little bit about the definition, but it's a natural connection, even though I just met Derry on Thursday afternoon. It was quite amazing, this whole idea of subversion. It's so great to be here with a diverse collection of educators, students, and community activists. I mean, we all are, as educators, community activists. It's always wonderful to be in the company of like-minded people who are so deeply invested in today and the impact we can all have on tomorrow. A big shout out to Richard Francham. He's the consummate unifier for bringing us all out of our isolation and into this virtual forum. So thank you, Richard. So just to give you a little personal context around how education has played out in my life, I was not a high achieving student. In fact, many of my teachers would be probably surprised to see me sitting here talking to a group of educators. I have to admit there are many black holes in my education. And I can't even remember what I did in those black holes. And I know that as an educator now, that black holes are often filled with worksheets, repetitive routines, and disconnected learning. So I think as educators, we work to ensure that there's flow and interest in what we do in schools. Teachers often said I daydreamed a lot, and it took me until I was an adult to realize that a child's dreams actually are made of life-enriching ingredients. And when schools capture the magic of children's dreams, well, we know that the future is in good hands. So if our schools do that, we can move ahead and we can solve any problems that we encounter. So in my 30 plus years as an educator around the world, in schools in Africa, in Central America, in the United States, and back home here in Canada, I've been witness to the ebb and flow of ideas in education, like all educators. Some of us are familiar with the terms like whole language and balanced day and Bansho math and guided this and that and three-part math. These all are ideas let's face it, are old ideas with new names in some cases. And it's a swinging pendulum that we live in that educators tend to ignore as the wiser they get. And I guess maybe I'm on that edge of beginning to really question some of the things that I've experimented with through my years as an educator. It's not that these ideas are bad, and I certainly don't want that message to come across, but it's more about that they're really just grains of sand in a massive desert. And if we think of that massive desert as democratic education, well then these little ideas really don't matter as much. We have bigger fish to fry in education. And these flavors of the day in our schools tend to distract us from what education should really be all about. As the late Sir Ken Robinson often said, learning, education, and school are unfortunately not synonymous with each other. Learning is, we have to admit, universally loved, but education gets bogged down in bureaucracies that frame learning into time allocation models and establish standardized levels of achievement. that a child must climb through. It is this bureaucratization of education that disintegrates ideas into subjects, so they are packaged into a factory-style input-output type model that Yakov was talking about earlier. And then guess what happens? The school bells start ringing, and the students are trained to stop and start, move here and there, are told to sit here, complete that, hand in this, and so on. And in fact, during this COVID reality, I think it's even more so the case. And it makes the case that is this not the opportunity to reset? For the most part, today's system is still based on this conventional model. But there's a key ingredient that is changing and that gives us all hope, and it is the teacher. And it's really my job, my new job, to be advocating for teachers. They are the one cog in this education machine who is guided by their knowledge of the whole child, understanding the value of meaningful experiences, making connections, expanding the walls of the classroom into the community that is part of the lives of all the people that we need to include as part of our communities. And that includes the Indigenous community here in Canada, includes the Black Lives Matter community. Those communities have to be a pillar of our public education system. And it's only then that we can make learning real and relevant. So teachers are the facilitators of threshold adventures. As another mentor of mine, Sir John Jones, says, it is the surfing model of learning, where the learner is allowed to catch a wave and improvise and maintain balance and momentum along the way. When a child has an opportunity to catch their wave of hopes and dreams, they embark on an improvisation supported by teachers and parents and the community around them, so they can ride their wave to its creative conclusion. So today it is teachers who are able to give themselves and the children they work with the permission to be free learners. And yes, we, the teachers, have to be free learners. We have to be open-minded. And Derry Hanum is one of those people. So teachers play an increasingly important role. They are the ones that collectively have the power to transform the old industrial model of education. So how does it change? Subversion has been traditionally defined as undermining the power and authority of an established institution or system. But in reading Derry Hanum's words, I'm reminded that within the context of education, teachers are the responsible subversives who have reframed subversion to mean the act of transforming systems and directives to ensure ministries of education and our schools are synonymous with a child's love of learning. So today, as a union leader, I see my role as an ally of, an advocate for, the responsible subversives, the teachers who take children on co-constructed adventures, like in my life and in my career, building gardens, cooking, songwriting, and exploring neighborhoods, forests, riverbanks, all the while becoming local solutionaries and community activists. Unions exist to support students and their teachers and to protect learning conditions that define schools as democratic places where hopes and dreams can be realized. So to end, I would like just to give a shout out to the responsible subversives who have been the mentors of my life before and now and into the future. Place-based educator David Sobel, who I studied with down in New England. Malala from Pakistan for her perseverance and resilience to make education accessible to all. Greta Thunberg for speaking truth to power. Passy Solberg for his focus on building schools where children find their personalized pathways. And finally, I introduce to you a truly free learner and responsible subversive. Join me in welcoming Derry Hanum. Take it away, Derry.
Okay, thank you. That was really nice, Stephen. Thank you very much. I notice I'd like to welcome Alia and Simi from the UK, who I see have just joined us, and also Charlie from Estonia, who's just joined us. And I hope to give them a couple of minutes each at the end of my session. So maybe Stephen Hurley will be a little bit generous and give me a couple of extra minutes there. So I've been a teacher for 30 years and a school inspector in England. And then I worked with the Council of Europe and the UK government on citizenship and human rights education. It confirmed my belief that if you want young people to understand democracy, they have to do it in the everyday life of the school and not just listen to teachers talk about it. And in 2001, we were able to get participation and democratic decision-making and responsible action into the high school curriculum in England, until it was replaced by the next government with British values. Not quite so sure about that. I did some work that showed that genuinely student participative schools with effective student councils, with budgets and regular timetabled meetings, these were associated with fewer exclusions, better test scores and better attendance than authoritarian schools in similar socioeconomic environments. So we have some evidence on our side. I visited many democratic schools such as Sudbury Valley and Yakov's wonderful school in Hadera, asking what can our public school systems learn from these places. I regard them as pioneers of possibility. They show us what can be done. Now, our state school system in England is not a happy place right now. It's preoccupied with financial cuts, test scores, prescriptive curriculum, authoritarian hierarchical structures, behavior management, punitive isolation rooms, exclusions, inspections, league tables, you name it, it's going on, with high levels of mental illness in our young people. We're even testing four-year-olds against the wishes of their teachers. And even though we know the predictive value is approximately zero, though putting a young child on a slow table in kindergarten will certainly damage their self-esteem and inhibit their future learning. Sadly, I feel in my country, we've forgotten that we're signatories to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, not least Article 12. Young people miss their friends during the lockdown, but many did not miss lessons where they have no choice, no control, or no consent in their learning, where coercion is the norm. And this talk is about the implementation of two guiding principles in my work. Initially with younger secondary students aged 11 to 13, and then with 11 to 18s. The first principle, students should participate in decisions about their own learning, real self-directed and self-exploring learning around the purposes and interests of the kids themselves. And I shared Jerome Bruner's 3C's view of childhood, that children are naturally curious and collaborative, and they love to feel competent, added to the late Ken Robinson's naturally creative beliefs. These qualities of childhood match Peter Gray's educational instincts. He talks about curiosity, sociability, planfulness, and above all, playfulness. And for me, play and creativity are very closely linked. Maybe they're even the same thing. My second principle. Student participation in meaningful democratic decision-making in the everyday life of the class and the school. The creation of a human rights respecting democratic context for the learning. And this in itself is a major source of learning about who you are as a person, about democracy and citizenship. It involves creating non-coercive spaces within our compulsory school systems, pockets of democracy, if you like, where children of whatever age are treated with respect and capable of making many decisions for themselves and with each other. Recent lockdown experience in England, where primary schools had too few children for age-based classes and they were unable to use the formal curriculum, they found that mixed age play with minimal teacher intervention has been wonderful to watch, quite educational for some teachers, and often the younger children seem to take the lead. Peter Gray is finding the same in his play club research in US elementary schools. Well, when I was at school, learning about democracy and human rights was like reading holiday brochures in prison. Not much point unless you are about to be released or about to escape. My primary school wasn't interested in what I was interested in. It just made me feel anxious and no good at things. And then in secondary school, I was top of the class in the first year and bottom of the class in the second. Nobody bothered to ask why. I was just told that I needed to pay more attention in lessons and stop dreaming my own thoughts. My main thought was, how the hell do I get out of here? And I left school at the earliest possible age. My best learning memory of this time was learning to sail with our local church, which my mum cleaned. And because of that, I got a free place on the priest's sailing trips. Every Easter, he rented a fleet of 5-berth sailing boats, and each trip you moved up the chain of command. So the time I was 14, I was a skipper, of a crew of mixed ages, some older than me. It was authority based on competence, and I really liked that. Years later, as an English school inspector, I visited Sudbury Valley School and found something similar. I was shown round by a 12-year-old boy. I asked to see the music room, where I started to play a tune on the lovely grand piano sat in Doll by Duke Ellington. Now, I really apologise for those of you who've heard this before, because you'll have heard my attempt at a Massachusetts accent. But the boy said to me, "Oh, Derry, if you do that, I'll have to bring you up to the JC. "What's that?" I asked, feeling pretty guilty. "It's the Judicial Committee. You need to be certified to play the musical instruments here." "Oh, how do I get certified?" And you got to remember that in the UK, being certified means you're about to be admitted to psychiatric hospital. "You have to be certified by a member of the Music Corporation." "What's the Music Corporation?" I asked. "Ah," he said, "it's all the students and staff who understand how to take care of musical instruments." "Oh, okay. So who's a member of the Music Corporation?" I asked. "Well, I am," he said. "I play the violin." "Great," I said. "Can you certify me? What do I have to do?" "Oh, play me something you love," he said. So I played Sat in Doll again, but this time I didn't get interrupted. "My, that's pretty," he said. "You're certified," and he wrote my name on a list on the wall. I love telling this story at official conferences in England. It says so much about respect for young people's knowledge, autonomy, and competence in a structure that genuinely shares power and authority in the school community. Well, during my teacher training, I found books by A.S. Neill, Homer Lane, John Dewey. Wow, the world lit up. At Summerhill, I read that children could choose what they wanted to learn while sharing in the democratic management of the school. I wanted to try it in a state school. I didn't know if it could be done, but I thought it was worth a try. And at my first teaching practice, I got in early on the first day and arranged the chairs in a circle. The kids arrived and were puzzled when I sat in the circle. But I explained that they could either create their own projects on anything they liked individually or in groups, or they could do the worksheets that I'd prepared. I just asked that they would present their projects to the rest of the class at the end of my stay. We started every day with a class meeting and made decisions by voting. It was a great success. Parents got involved. As Yakov said, they're this enormous resource, the parents, as well as all the things the teachers know that aren't part of their subjects. Anyway, the head was delighted and I got A+ for my teaching practice. Nobody chose to use the worksheets, by the way. My next teaching practice was in an authoritarian secondary school and it was a disaster. I'll say no more about that, except I was a responsible subversive and you don't always get away with it. But for my last teaching practice, the class teacher was an ex-army officer. And when I said that I wanted to try and create a democratic class meeting and get the 10-year-old kids creating their own projects, instead of saying over my dead body, he said, "Fantastic, I've always wanted to try something like that." And we worked together brilliantly. Parents again became involved and we ended up with a class festival. The head teacher was delighted and I got another A. In my final year, I moved into Oxford University. Academically, it was amazing. You had choice and control over your own learning. If you handed in your essay each week, you could go to any lecture in any subject that interested you. And recent research shows a close correlation between autonomy and happiness. So at last I was a happy learner, though I wasn't too happy about the English class system, but that's another subject. My first job was as a humanities teacher in a secondary modern school to teach English history, geography, social studies, and religious education to one class of 34 11-year-olds for 60% of the week. Now, these kids had just failed a high-stakes test at 11 called the 11+. Few went to university from this kind of school. It was a school for failures, which incidentally was 80% of the kids. The principal wanted some integration of subjects, so the heads of subject departments were very against it. I joined a team of 7 with scheduled planning time, and I was given my own large classroom. This gave me the 3 T's that I think are important for class democracy in a state school: time, for lots of talk, for a class meeting, for students to become absorbed in what they were doing without bells ringing all the time and moving to other rooms, time for student presentations, etc. The second T, team, not to be on your own, but to have planning time and share ideas with others. And the third T is territory, to have a dedicated space with display and storage. So that was a good start. And on the first day, I arranged the chairs in a circle and sat in the circle myself. The children arrived and sat in the circle, and I told them my name, my first name and my family name. And I said that in our classroom, I could be Derry, but anywhere else, it would have to be Mr. Hannam. I explained the five subjects: history, the past, geography, other parts of the world, social studies, how people live in communities, religious knowledge, what people believe in, English, how people communicate. And one boy called David, who I'm still in touch with, he said, "That sounds like everything in the whole world. Can we learn about anything in the world?" So I thought, well, that's a good start. Several people wanted to speak at once, so I got a book off my desk and said, "I propose that you should only speak when you're holding the book and then pass it to somebody else." Who agrees? Hands went up. Who disagrees? Hands went up. We counted the hands. So we were voting already and making class rules. Every night I made notes of how the class democracy evolved with its class meeting, class laws, which I explained could not break the laws of England or the rules of school, but otherwise they were free to make their own laws. We had a class court very similar to the JC in a Sudbury school, which became necessary as the growing number of laws were broken. We had class clubs, class newspaper. Many of the students directed their own projects. All the students directed their own projects. Many jobs were created. Everyone did something, often several different jobs. The popular jobs, such as editor of the class newspaper or chair of the class meeting, class secretary or class treasurer, these were all elected and had deputies. The secretary minuted all the class meetings and the decisions of the class court. Everyone experienced chairing meetings. Everyone learned to speak in meetings. They even created a class taxation system of a penny a week to buy games for the class cupboard. Well, I ignored most of the prescribed subject curriculum. The students chose their own projects, preferably in groups, but on their own if necessary. I suggested a kind of plan, do, and review process as a model, but I didn't make a big thing about it as I was too aware of the role of serendipity in my own learning. The kids were more concerned about a perfect finished project than I was. I adopted what you might call a Socratic approach, asking many questions to deepen their thinking, but never telling them what to do, just assisting when invited. They decided when a project was finished or when it should be abandoned, though this was quite rare. We agreed that everyone would share their projects with the rest of the class, even if they'd not been totally successful. Sometimes as a presentation or sometimes in the class newspaper, which had an elected editor and many sub-editors for different columns, such as sport, music, pets, fashion, model railways, etc., etc., etc. The newspaper gradually covered all the walls and the door. Projects were never graded for their finished product, though we used to evaluate effort and process together, which I would record as I had to report to parents and at least appear to be following the school's assessment policy. Short story writing and poetry became very popular. The art and drama teachers became very supportive and used the ideas in their lessons. Artwork began to illustrate the poetry anthologies that the class produced and sold to parents. Years later, I was persuaded by Alfie Cohn, who some of you will know, to write a book about the class, and an extraordinary thing happened. A 60-year-old bald-headed man, who I sort of recognized, appeared on my Facebook. "I'm Andrew from your class 1H, and I read an article by you in the teacher's newspaper, and I see you're still at it," he said. It was an amazing piece of synchronicity, because I was just writing about an incident involving him. One day the head teacher had come to my classroom with some visitors and I wasn't there, but the kids were all working quietly. I was in the library helping someone find a book. The visitors were puzzled that the room was quiet without a teacher. Excuse me. The now bald-headed Andrew was class chairman at the time, and he explained they were having a quiet time. The class had a law that if five people found it too noisy, they'd put their hands up and the timekeeper would announce 5 minutes quiet. If anyone spoke during a quiet time, their names were noted, five notations in a week, and they'd have to appear before the class court. Andrew told the visitors, I love this, our teacher is a bit soft, and if we didn't have our class government, it would be chaos in here. The head told me this with a chuckle while reprimanding me for leaving my class unsupervised. I said to him they were supervised. They were supervising themselves. Years later, Andrew became principal of a primary school, which he ran democratically. He's just retired. He was still in touch with others from the class, all in their late 50s, and we met up. Some have written pieces in my book saying that their lives owed quite a bit to their 2 years in the democratic class when they were 11. They'd recovered their confidence as learners after the dreadful 11 plus failure experience. Well, instead of getting fired, by the end of the year, the other parallel classes were all adopting democratic practices, class meetings, rules, court, clubs, fund, class newspaper, much to the annoyance of my class, who they thought they'd invented it all. The head decided to take the humanities experiment into the second year, and I was put in charge of the team, 7 teachers, 240 kids, for 60% of the school week. I mean, this teacher, the head teacher, was either very brave or crazy, or maybe both. Anyway, we adopted democracy and student-directed learning across the whole year group. We created a second-year students' parliament that became a school council in the end. We hooked up with the drama and art departments. We produced plays, poetry anthologies, exhibitions for parents. Kids could move from teacher to teacher, as all the classes were timetabled at the same time in adjacent classrooms. We used the school hall, and teachers from other departments or parents would give talks on things that interested them, and kids who wanted to attend could attend. Kids could go to presentation by kids in other classes if the topic interested them. The presentation happened when the kids were ready. Oh, by the way, I was told to mention this. Kids went to the toilet when they wanted to, just telling a teacher where they were going. How extraordinary that I should have to even mention that. Anyway, sometimes my class gave lectures at the local teachers' colleges about class democracy. That was really nice. Presentations were planned in detail. I was instructed by the kids to explain how it all worked to get the attention of the audience. And then everyone in the class who had some responsible job, which was just about everybody, would talk about what they did. Well, the student teachers didn't want to listen to me, but they certainly wanted to listen to the kids. It was great. We never had any difficulty filling the time. 12-year-olds were teaching the teachers. We were written up in The Sun, a national tabloid newspaper owned by the Murdochs. One of the mothers had a brother who was a reporter, and she told him that in her daughter's democratic class, she was learning a lot and how much she was enjoying being editor of the class newspaper. Well, the reporter wanted to visit the class with the photographer. The kids were wildly enthusiastic. I forgot to tell the head teacher and ask his permission, but I've learned in life that it's often easier to do things and apologize afterwards rather than ask permission beforehand and have people say no. There was a boy called Ian who was not usually antisocial, but he started breaking all the class laws. The newspaper people arrived and sat in the meeting. There were many questions from editors of columns in the class newspaper about what's it like working on a real newspaper. Then came the class court, with Ian in the dock as the only offender. Sally was the chief magistrate judge with a big hammer to call the court to order, and David and Peter were her assistants. I don't know if you can see this. I've got a picture of the report in The Sun about this visit. And there's me at the back with my hand up. And there's Sally and David and Peter with a hammer calling the class, calling the court to order. Anyway, I realized that Ian had been really cunning. He'd worked out that the best way to get his picture in the paper was to get himself tried in the court, and he was right. The paper paid for a bus to take us all to London to meet the editor and be presented with the first 34 copies signed by him that came off the press. Some of the kids, when we met up 45, 48 years later, had still got these copies of the newspaper, which is interesting. So it showed this was a pretty important experience. I was very nervous, but in fact, the story was quite friendly and supportive of democracy in schools as education for citizenship. There was a large picture of Ian and the class judges with me at the back with my hand up asking for permission to speak. I was really quite interested the way the reporter wrote this. He said, "Form teacher Derry Hannam, age 30, has to ask to speak in the court. His pupils have been known to suggest that his remarks were totally irrelevant." I really like that. Yes, it's quite funny, actually, being a democratic teacher sometimes. The head teacher was annoyed that I hadn't asked his consent, but the parents loved it. And that's the best way to please head teachers, please the parents. The kids were turning on to learning, including how to manage a justice and rights respecting democratic community. Kohlberg and Gilligan were writing about moral development at this time based on the work of Piaget. In the second year, we admitted a very troubled girl from a Romani gypsy family. She'd been bullied and victimized in her previous schools, and she'd become an aggressive bully herself. We put her into my class as I thought they might be strong enough to control her behavior and even to help her. She made friends with some older students in the school and began to bully and steal, but never from anyone in my class, where she was cautious of the laws and the class court. Eventually, the head teacher decided she would have to be permanently excluded as parents were beginning to complain. My class found out about this, and one day walking back to our classroom, I met some of my students who said, "Derry, we're having a class meeting after school to discuss what we can do to help Joe. You can come too if you like." I loved that. I was supposed to be the teacher, and they were telling me that I could come too. Of course, that was a beautiful experience. They had called the meeting, and after a long discussion, one boy said we should be nice to Joe one day and then nasty to her the next, like not talk to her, to see what worked. That was rejected as a pretty unpleasant idea. And eventually the class decided they would do the kindest thing that they could think of. The class captain resigned, and so did the chief judge, Sally, from the class court. And Joe was elected in her absence to both those jobs, the most important jobs in the class in the view of the kids. The chief judge, Sally, said that if Joe became a judge, she would realize what effect antisocial behavior had on other people. The next morning when she arrived, a special class meeting was called and Joe was told she'd been unanimously elected to both jobs. She burst into tears and ran from the room. Some kids went to fetch her, and when she came back, she said, "Nobody's ever been kind to me in school before." Well, interestingly, her bullying and stealing stopped, and the head teacher was persuaded not to exclude her. The young people in the class had developed a mature and moral concern for each other through having real power and real responsibility. Through sharing responsibility and having the freedom to make real choices, they had become responsible. They could never have grown in this way if they'd just been told what to do all the time. Parents were overwhelmingly supportive during these 2 years, and they were thrilled to see confidence returning to their children after the blow of the 11 plus failure. This kept the head happy. Gradually, democratic methods spread through the whole school. Well, that's a long story, I can't tell it here, but I moved to another school after 2 years. And here we had a special building where we could have 200 students at a time for 25% of the curriculum with a team of 10 teachers. That was brilliant. After 3 years, I moved again to become vice principal of a community secondary school where we experimented with mixed age classes and including adults in. If an adult was going on holiday to France, they could come into the French class and do some French along with the kids. but always with two guiding principles: as much self-directed learning as possible in a democratic and rights-respecting context. My 10 years as an inspector were not so interesting, except that I was able to support Summerhill School when the government tried to close it. I suppose you could say I was lucky. In England, too many young teachers enter the profession full of idealism, but they become depressed by the end of their first year. 50% of English teachers want to leave the classroom within 5 years. The best ones are often the first to go. It's tragic. But nonetheless, I believe it's always possible to do something if we're opportunists about creating pockets of democracy. I recommend Wayne Jennings. I don't know if he's here today. He was here yesterday. Wayne Jennings has written a lovely book about school transformation, where he talks about the hypocrisy of school mission statements. It's worth reading his book just for that. It's totally brilliant. But currently, the English school system takes very little regard for the interests, strengths, and passions of each student and doesn't help them discover and develop their own self-actualized identity. But we have a few schools that are not like this. And in our next session, you're going to hear about a citywide youth-led movement for change in Portsmouth, which is supported by the teachers. That's Portsmouth, UK, rather than all the Portsmouths in the US. I'll conclude with three proposals for the public school systems. First, we need to create departments for alternative education within our ministries of education to create experimental democratic schools that are free for parents. Second, all schools should introduce the 20% principle. Yakov and I have talked a lot about this. 20% of curriculum time should be available for all children of all ages, ideally in mixed age groups, to practice self-directed learning around their own interests and passions. This could be one whole day or two half days a week, or even just 20% of time in subject lessons. Schools should create a 20% committee of staff and students to plan how this program would be organized. This would introduce the idea of students participating in serious school decision-making, not just about the color of the paintwork in the toilets. A 20% department should be created, led by a teacher of assistant principal status and staffed by teachers from all subjects who wanted to work in this way. This would gradually create a team of experienced self-directed learning facilitators. It could have its own part of the buildings, the 20% wing, where presentations of student projects could be held. An entirely new approach to assessment would be required, based on processes rather than finished projects. Failure would be something to be learned from and not to be feared. So 20% of students of mixed ages would be in the 20% department at any one time. Recently, The Economist newspaper produced a report called Staff 2030, The Future of Teacher Training. It recommended 20% of curriculum time for student-directed learning, claiming that the competences developed are precisely those required for the future workplaces of the fourth industrial revolution. The autonomous learners and creators which our current school system is not producing. It's ironic, isn't it, that the evolved nature of human childhood, as described by Bruner and Peter Gray, now aligns with the needs of enlightened employers, yet so few schools are making the connection. Google already provides staff with 20% of their paid time to develop projects that interest them, not directly related to the company projects. In fact, Susan Wojcicki, now CEO of YouTube, created Gmail in her 20% time when she was at Google. A 20 time movement is growing in California, known as innovation or moonshot time, where students are free to come up with their own idea of what they want to do and study and how they want to do it. Your students will be future ready if you give them time, says the project. And time is perhaps the greatest gift we can give young people. We must stop filling every moment at school and at home with coercive curriculum. They've realized this in Finland, where the school day is short and there's little set homework. The students of democratic schools know how to participate in managing their communities while respecting human rights, and they learn to discover their own individual genius. create their own identities rather than being defined by test scores. As paid employment declines, this will enable them to be unique, creative, socially responsible individuals and not rely on full-time paid work for their identity. Soon, we'll need some form of universal basic income to support this. My third idea, and here's where I'd like to bring in Charlie, is create more alternative democratic schools within large mainstream schools, schools within schools. These would offer parents, students, and teachers the choice of a full-time, self-directed, and democratic school experience within a conventional school. There's quite a history of such schools in the United States, but recently the idea has spread to Europe. We've got examples in London, in Prague, and in Tallinn. And Charlie Moreno-Romero from Suvamai School in Estonia is here today. And I wonder, Charlie, if you could just for a couple of minutes, I'm sorry the time is so short, but just tell us a little bit about your project. By the way, Suvamai, and it's no coincidence, translates from Estonian into Summer Hill. How strange. Anyway, Charlie, a couple of minutes.
Thank you very much, Jerry. It's so good to hear the story that I have read a couple of times already from your own voice. It's very inspiring. And I thank everyone here. It's a pleasure. Greetings from Tallinn, Estonia. We have had during the last year and 2 months, 3 months almost, this pilot school. It's a democratic branch within a public school. And it has been a really interesting learning experience. I got together with members of civil society, people interested in a different kind of education, also parents who wanted an alternative for their children, who saw that the conventional standardized solution imposition was not good for their children. Also members from the ADHD community, parents of kids who had been diagnosed. And then we had the possibility to meet a school leader who had been working on or promoting project-based days and interest-based lessons that last for a trimester. To her, the step seemed kind of natural. And we started, perhaps at this moment, I would say a bit too ambitiously, with 60 kids in a small house next to the main house in this municipal school from different backgrounds and started building the school with them. At the moment, we have around 73 kids from these different socioeconomic linguistic backgrounds. We speak three languages in the school, Estonian, English, and Russian. So far, so good. Lots of challenges. I could say that on the one hand, there is, at least in my perspective, a year ago, I would say that it didn't exist, a tremendous addiction dependency to screens by kids. Most of the times they have to do with entertainment, cheap entertainment, TikTok, YouTube, rather than creating with those tools that is possible. There is, or what we see, a dependency on entertainment and fill my time with fun. So we also have to address these issues together with the kids. The school hangover, the expectations, and perhaps preconceived ideas of what learning looks like by kids from age 11 onwards is in there. There is a strong process, you know, giving them the possibility also to get bored without organizing the timetable with stuff and things that perhaps are not part of their interests. We have been going through a process of political apathy in the sense of why do I have to participate in making decisions with you guys? It has been addressed also, you know, through the involvement of the students from the youngest to the oldest in decision-making, in responsibility positions, in let's organize an excursion, let's invite people, what do we want to learn, let's write to these people and invite them to the school and so on. Bringing inspiring people also, but at the same time, allowing kids to have, develop the learning at their own pace. even if that means getting bored, not doing anything, taking a sabbatic year. Our kids feel that they feel very safe. They feel that we live in a community that listens to each other. Lots of challenges, lots of kids coming from troubled backgrounds with violence. So far, we believe we need more time. Maybe we could have started with less people, and this is an advice that I would share. 30 kids, 3-4 members of staff, but definitely kids are capable. They're showing that whenever they have the opportunity to share the interests and to explore together, they take it. It might take some time. But it is a really interesting experience, and now we have to combine with on the one hand with the Corona situation. So once a week, 2 classes from our school stay at home, and they develop self-directed projects together through a coaching with adults. And on the other hand, well, we had to deal also with the state requirements. So during the period of 6 months, we had 3 different inspections by the local educational authorities. They knew what we were going to do. They knew what we are doing. They know it. But there is a bit of skepticism in that. This has brought us, this kind of skeptic eye onto our doings, have brought us to a situation in which we have to come to compromises. Without compromising the decision-making, the shared decision-making mechanisms, or the conflict resolution mechanisms in which they look like a judicial committee, but a bit, let's say, less informal, involving kids and adults, we have to come to a compromise to what is required by the state, the minimum requirements. And this has to do with around 50% of the time of the students' time in the school dedicated to 3 main subjects: Estonian language, mathematics, and the natural sciences. We are trying to get together and think in terms of interdisciplinary projects based on their interests. And then we have 50% of the time for themselves, whatever they want to organize. Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
A couple more people I need to bring in. I'm getting up to the end of my time. I just want to end my session on a note that gives me enormous hope. All around the world, we're seeing campaigns for change coming from young people themselves. In England, there's a group called Teach the Future, which is arguing for a much better climate change curriculum in schools. Now, they wanted to be here, but they've got their own event today, COP26 event in Scotland, so they send their apologies. Another group called Pupil Power is here, and I'm so pleased to introduce Alia and Simi, who are with us now, to say a few words about Pupil Power. It will be a few words, I'm afraid, folks, because we're up against the time. But tomorrow, Simi and Alia will be with me for the SOFA debate at the same time tomorrow, and you'll hear much more from them. But over to you now, you two, and you've got 5 minutes, I guess.
Thank you so much, Derry. Hello, everybody. My name is Alia. I am 17 years old. I'm the founder of Pupil Power, and I'm really glad to have Simi, who's another key member of Pupil Power and the movement. So Pupil Power is a youth-led movement. We're based in the UK, and we engage with as many young people as possible to try and engage and educate young people on the mission of educational transformation. In a nutshell, we're just trying to challenge young people to reimagine what the 21st century education system looks like. We are currently experiencing school Monday to Friday, and we want to put ourselves in a position where we can be critical thinkers and reflect on what's working, what's not working, and how things can be better for the future. So having been in the UK education system for over a decade now, the idea of democratic schooling is one that is quite unfamiliar to me, and it's quite disappointing to say. Although it is very polarised from our current existing state of schools, we want to encourage ourselves as young people to think about what it means to introduce democratic schooling into our current education system. So whoever you are, wherever you are, I think it's really important for even when we leave this call to start thinking about how we champion democratic schooling and how we champion youth voice, because as young people, a part of the movement of people power, it's kind of in the name, we try to champion young voices, promote fairness and really center young people and their ideas, because from my experience of school so far, that has simply not been happening. So before, I don't want to say too much, so Simi has some to say, but some of the greatest moments that I'm really proud of what people power have been doing was our challenge against, our legal challenge against the Prime Minister during the coronavirus pandemic, where he essentially stopped under 18s from submitting a parliamentary question and submitting a question for the coronavirus daily briefings. And so when young people went onto the website, it literally said you couldn't submit a question because you were under 18. And so young people, a part of People Power, were extremely annoyed, frustrated, and just didn't actually understand or couldn't comprehend why our voices were being silenced and why our voices were being shut down. So we came together and we got legal support to take action against that. And although they didn't do the very best in terms of their response to that, there were a few initiatives that were taking place afterwards. We also did some work with the Children's Research Centre, a part of the Open University, which was a whole event championing youth voice and promoting what it means to be democratic in school and how it really means to essentially dismantle the tokenistic style of education that we have at the moment, whereby we have school councils and, you know, leadership in school, and you're only kind of told to create like a little event and not actually have the sort of resources and support to create real tangible changes. So it's really exciting to be here. I've really enjoyed listening to the speakers, and I want to pass on to Simi to talk about more about what it means to be about involved in People Power. Thank you, everybody.
You're brilliant. Thanks, Ali.
Thank you, Leah. Hi, I'm Simi. I'm 16 years old, from London, part of People Power. I think People Power has been such an amazing experience, and over the lockdown, I think it's just grown and grown. It's been a really useful movement for helping to connect young people, which I think is really the key to creating this change, whether it be enacting democratic education or just empowering young people. I think this sort of collaboration between young people from all many different locations, as people from People Power who are miles away from where I am, but we can still connect because we're united by this like one goal of creating a better education system that better empowers young people to be more, to go into the wider world. And I think it's been really interesting to start to connect with educators and teachers as well, who also have that sort of vision for change of more self-directed and democratic education. I think it's been really inspiring to find out more about that and also work together and collaboratively for a future that everyone kind of sees.
Thanks, Simi, so much. I think it's appropriate for me to end my session there with the voices of the young people. Do we have a few minutes for any questions, Stephen, or are we going to do it as we did for Yakov?
Well, we do have a couple minutes, if it's okay with Richard. If there are some questions, we'll go up to 11 o'clock on that and take a 5-minute break.
Okay.
Only 4 minutes, but I'll give you that.
Thank you, Stephen. You're so nice. I haven't been looking in the chat, so I have no idea what questions people have put there. So I guess someone's going to have to do that for me, or can you put your hand up?
Or if there's someone that's been reading the chat that that has a particularly interesting question or has seen one.
Absolutely.
This is Thomas. I just want to take a second here to say how powerful it is to hear the two young people who just spoke and how much that adds to our efforts and attention here. So thank you so much.
I was just going to say that one of the questions in the chat says, would your model work for grades kindergarten to grade 3?
I was, funnily enough, this week I've been in Turkey. It's amazing, this Zoom thing, how you zoom around, you know, Kathmandu one day, Warsaw the next. But I've been in Turkey for a couple of days this week with 100 kindergarten and early years teachers. Talking about this, and they, of course, had probably more ideas from me than me. But one of the things we all agreed on, that play was crucial, and that the idea of creating an early years curriculum is really an oxymoron. It makes no sense at all. And in England, we're even testing little kids. It's quite bizarre. I mentioned this in my talk, but I was going pretty quickly. I've actually been in a kindergarten where they had three tables. One was the behind table, the slow table. One was the average table, and the other one was gifted and going ahead table. And this, for God's sake, was with four-year-olds. And I was very shocked and let them know what I thought of it. And they thought, well, you don't know what we're dealing with because we've got the inspectorate breathing down our necks. The sad thing is the teachers don't believe in what they're doing. The teachers know it's rubbish and they know it's harmful, but they're somehow that they're not sufficiently standing up for themselves. I wish that teachers had something like the Hippocratic Oath that doctors have to swear before they can practice as medics. You know, I promise I will do no harm. And really, teachers need the equivalent. What would the equivalent of Hippocrates be for teachers? Socrates, a Socratic Oath, perhaps, I will do no harm. And this idea is beginning to catch on with the teachers' union in England. I could see that maybe within 12 months we will have something like that. And that will be, you know, the defense at the Nuremberg trials. I was just obeying orders. It's really not good enough. And teachers have got to stand up to this nonsense. But the kindergarten teachers in Turkey, we're having another meeting next week. They're real gluttons for punishment. They want to continue the discussion. Not so much with me, I'm kicking some ideas around, but basically it's what they're learning from each other about the extent to which really young children can make good decisions about their learning. And this makes you think about Peter Gray's work, where Peter Gray talks about hunter-gatherer bands and the way in which quite little children will play with older children and learn from each other. Yakov talked about this, the importance of kids learning from each other. Peter's very enthusiastic about it, and the little kids should have adults available, not necessarily their own parents, but there should be adults around when they need help. And one of the things that's been spotted by some elementary school teachers through the pandemic here, which again I mentioned in my talk, but I went rather quickly, is that because only some kids were coming to school, the teachers weren't able to make full age group classes following the national curriculum. They couldn't follow the national curriculum because half the kids or more weren't there. So they allowed a lot more play than usual. And what they observed was the little kids, 3 and 4 year olds, were often coming up with the ideas and bringing the older kids into the games. And this is something again that Peter's noticed. Peter's doing research. It's the play club research. I don't know how many elementary schools, but quite a few in the US, where before school starts, there's just an hour set aside where little kids aged 3 to 9 are able to play for an hour with adults that don't intervene unless there's some sort of safety problem. But the kids are just allowed to play for an hour. And this is having a transforming effect on the attitude of kids to coming to school. I'm sure Peter Gray will be writing this up very shortly. Anyway, the answer to your question is, I think we can do a massive amount with little kids in introducing self-directed learning through play and through changing the ethos, the environments that we've created, even in kindergartens in England. And I'd say the idea of testing little kids seems quite mad, wicked, actually. And I really blame the testing companies who are selling their wares to government under the title of this is how you improve standards. They collect a lot of data and then they sell that to government. But the whole thing is totally pernicious, in my opinion.
So there's a rabbit hole, if I've ever seen one. And we can jump down that another time. Thank you so much, Derry, and thank you to everyone that's been part of this conversation. We're going to take 3 minutes. We'll take 3 minutes, which means we'll be back at 11:06, and we'll get started with our next presentation. So grab that glass of water, that maybe the fourth cup of coffee for the day, and we'll see you back in a couple minutes.
Thank you, Stephen.
For those of us waiting here, Stephanie, you started to try to share something also? if you feel like.
Me, Stephanie, or the other Stephanie?
I think it was you, right? That
I did have something, but I only have, I'm trying to multitask, which is totally impossible because it's everything that everybody is saying is way too interesting.
Yeah, exactly.
So my question for the young people who are here today, like 22 and younger, what, I don't even know exactly how to form the question, but it's something around like for us older than 20, a conference is like, yeah, it's exciting. We toss ideas around and we put links in the chat and, you know, like that's kind of our MO for connecting and for creating ideas and for working with ideas. Whenever I've talked to a young person about this conference, it's like, oh yeah, that sounds interesting, but I know they're not going to come. Like I can see it. And it's not their way of connecting. And in spite of the fact that I have two young people living in my house, I can't quite figure out how to like truly bring those voices in. And so I'm really curious from the young people that are here, like, what is it that we're trying to bring more young people into this kind of setting? Or is it that are the conversations inherently different and between, you know, people our age and younger people? Or do we need to go into a different environment to have these conversations? You know, how do people who are, especially people who are like 15, 16, 17, who've been through the system, but can see the light at the end of the tunnel for themselves, what compels you to be involved in this conversation? Why are you here? And how can we invite more of your feedback into this?
I don't mind answering, and I don't know if Simi's still here. That was an amazing question. I think as a young person who's a part of Pupil Power in itself, we still realise and witness when other young people are not engaging or somehow just feel like they don't want to take part in it. And it's almost frustrating because it's like, it's your education as well. It's not just mine that we're fighting for. It's yours as well. It's your siblings. It's your future. And so for us, it is frustrating. But I think really the thing... it's a hard code to crack, to be honest, but I think some of the factors are, one, some of the young people feel like it's not going to affect them, and it, that idea of, with Pupil Power, we centre our stories around the work that we do, so it's our realities, our stories, what drive everything, and I think that's what's picked up the most engagement with young people, because they then hear different stories from different young people, from different backgrounds, from different locations in the UK, and they're like, wait, I can connect to that, and they're like, hey, wait, that's the effect that it's had on that person. That's also happened to me too. And look at how this person's trying to do something about it and not just be passive about it. Maybe I need to do something too and, you know, pull my socks up a little bit. So I think that's one of the things about sharing our stories, because we've got so many different types of young people from different places, different backgrounds. We share our stories from different experiences, from whether it's exclusions, whether it's to even racism in school, whether it's to just the curriculum, feeling like, you know, you don't get to have your voice heard, whatever it is, we share our stories. And second of all, I think there's a difference between, I'm trying to figure out what the word it is, but I think there's activism and then what we're doing, where it's like, it's so urgent, the work that we're doing. I think a lot of people see it as like, oh, we're just talking about what's wrong in the world. Whereas this is like, we're talking about what's wrong, but we also need to take action. And so the work that we're doing, young people see the clear actions that they can do that are easy, and that, you know, it's not just like in a picture or just attending an event one time, because people think, if I attend that event, what's going to happen afterwards? So we try to encourage for our own events and other people to always be action focused and to always have tangible things that we can do where we feel like we're actually doing something that's have an impact. I think that's what's really important. So we're not just turning up to an event and being passive and just listening, but we're doing something that's really, really meaningful. And that is through adults bridging with young people, because that doesn't happen enough. Young people are, I promise you guys, young people are out there. They are having these conversations, very similar things being said. And like Derry said a couple of times as well, it's like, we're both having these conversations, but just in separate spaces. And so it's really important for myself, for us to bridge that. And that is through us being able to understand each other. I think young people also are aware of the power structures that are within school, and so they're less reluctant to engage with adults and teachers because they realize the relationships that they have in schools don't allow that to happen all the time. And so for me, it's really important to make sure that we bridge that gap and say, you know, there's amazing adults there that want the same thing as us, and we want it too. So if we come together, then we're going to get there 10 times faster. And sometimes I think one last thing to say, that includes adults almost listening more than they speak, because sometimes young people feel as if, like, you know, they're being, you know, that the adults are dominating and that their voices aren't heard. And so there's so many amazing examples whereby adults and organizations are really, really just allowing us to take the stage, allowing us to talk, and really value us. And again, like I said, not doing it in a tokenistic manner. I hope that answered your question.
Absolutely. You gave me some really key things to think about. So I almost have a bit of a mischievous question. Like, Richard, I'm not, oh, sorry, Stephen. Can I ask the question and then and not have it answered?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. And Richard, I'm not suggesting that we actually do this, but Alia, if we handed over this conference to you right at this moment in time and said, all these people are here for the next, you know, 36 hours, what would you do with it? That's my question, but don't answer it.